Thank you very much. It's good to be here, and I thought it's time that we acknowledge that those of us who write in different voices are forming part of the diaspora that is also the stories about Canada. In my latest book, I wrote the story of the first son of the Jade Peony family who came to Canada when he was 3 years old in the 1900s, 1920s. And everybody who came at that time through a racist time and a very difficult time came with the past as part of the baggage. And even if you were three, as I was born in 1939, I was aware that those who raised me had ghosts to pass on to me. And I had the privilege of meeting some of them recently, having gone through some near-death experiences. And having survived, I'm pleased to say that we all, I think, have Canadian stories to tell. And this is one of them. It's from my last book, All That Matters. And the first son is narrating. When I was 3 years old in 1926, father, Popo, and I were sent away from our Toisan village to Hong Kong, sent away by the patriarch Chin, who was recently a mission house convert and the head of our clan. As a demonstration of his Christian charity, the old patriarch had agreed to clear the way for third uncle to sponsor us to come to Canada, so that father, grandmother, and I, first son, would have a chance to escape the famine and the civil wars raging in the Pearl River Delta of Guangdong Province. Those who could leave Seiyup, the four-county village district in southern China, would have a chance for a better existence, and those who settled in Gold Mountain might find work and send back remittances to help the ones left behind. Every sojourner would return home when life improved in China or when they had their pockets filled with gold. Much later, I learned that before he had put up the money and bought the documents for us to join him in Vancouver, Third Uncle had to consider the feelings of his dead wife. He consulted Chinatown's Madame Jing, who set up her fortune-telling table in Market Alley and had known him since he first arrived in Gold Mountain. She interpreted the final toss of the I Ching coins. "Ah, the spirit of your dead wife approves," she said. And soon after this sign of approval, American gold and large Mexican silver coins were paid into various hands. 6 months later, we sailed on an Empress steamer and landed in Victoria, then headed to Vancouver to settle in the Chinatown rooms that Third Uncle had rented for the three of us in a building on East Pender Street, just half a block from his warehouse on Shanghai Alley. Third Uncle was not my father's brother. In fact, he was a very distant cousin from Seiyup, connected to us only through our mutual clan name of Chin. His own blood brother had died years ago in the interior of British Columbia. Over 50 and as successful as an import-export warehouse merchant, Third Uncle had been shocked into acknowledging his own mortality. In less than a month, five of his Chinatown associates had died, two from heart attacks, two from the coughing sickness, and one from a stomach tumor. He confronted a chilling fact. He had no family members in Gold Mountain to carry on after him. What legacy then had 30 years of his work and investments built in Vancouver? He promptly decided to sponsor a namesake family from old China, a Maji Gating, a bought paper family that would replace what he himself had tragically lost. During the long period of civil unrest in southern China, Third Uncle's own wife and 10-year-old son had met a fearful end. The two were abducted by a peasant warlord and held for ransom. But the ransom note arrived in Vancouver with an incorrect address, the name on the oversized envelope badly blotched by rain, and for 3 months on the front window of the Chinese Times office, the indistinct envelope was displayed unclaimed. When it was finally opened and read, it was already too late. Another letter had arrived from Patriarch Chin to say that a box had turned up and it held the severed heads of Third Uncle's wife and his son. The two decapitated bodies were found in a neighboring field. Mercifully, the bones and skulls were brought together by Patriarch Chin for an appropriate burial, or their ghosts would have wandered hopelessly in the fields and ponds. Third Uncle wept to think that he had countless times walked past that large envelope. He had even laughed at the awkwardly constructed ideograms, as if a childish hand had struggled with each wavering stroke of the brush. He had wondered who was so ignorant or so ill-advised that they would not have hired a street calligrapher to write the words properly. It turned out that the words had been brushed by his own son. The Chinese Times retold this sad story and urged people to check carefully the still unclaimed envelopes taped to the Carroll Street windows. Some words are made unreadable by rain, the editor wrote, and some by tears. Years later, Third Uncle told me that after the loss of an older brother in Gold Mountain, and then of his own wife and son, he had no intentions of ever again enduring a blood loss. Further, after receiving the tragic news in the letter from Patriarch Chin, he had been warned by Madame Jing that if he dared to remarry, he would offend the ghosts of his angry wife and bring a curse upon himself. "Your wife feels you deserted her," the fortune teller had said, wagging her finger at him. "She saw you walking by that letter. She saw you laughing." During the years since that tragedy, Third Uncle kept good company with a few women companions in the Chinatown tea houses, but he never invited any of them to his private rooms in his main Shanghai Alley warehouse. He slept alone there, beside a fading picture of a tall woman and a young boy, and he never remarried. After 30 years in BC, and after keeping the memory of his wife and son for so long, though he remembered only a baby, the weight and size of a winter melon, when he left for Canada, and remembered clearly how he pushed the tiny penis and assured himself the infant was a boy. And shortly after the funeral of his fifth business peer, Wang Ying Sai, who boasted that death would never touch him until his 75th year, and who died at the age of 53, it was time for Third Uncle, then 53 himself, and a wealthy merchant with three warehouses, to sponsor a family from his clan to become his own kin. Such sponsorship schemes were not unusual for Chinatown, though only those merchants with enough money could manage them, bringing over to Gold Mountain their brother's whole family, for example, or a family member of a favorite concubine. Third Uncle quickly arranged with the Chin Association to assist him in sponsoring his paper family. Arrangements were made through Patriarch Chin back in our Toisan village to settle on the right person for Third Uncle to bring over. He wanted a much younger man who would know some English and would be able to work beside him and help him with his accounts. He would sponsor this man and two of his family members and pay for the documents and transportation to Gold Mountain. According to the agreement, this paper family would accept him as one of theirs, and as a gesture of goodwill, Third Uncle also agreed to donate a large sum of money to the China-Canada Mission House, which the Patriarch favored. Father, as it happened with his gift for studies, had been taught elementary English by the mission teachers. He had also been helping with their complex accounts, translating the Chinese and the English bills and invoices. His mother, my popo, had been one of Patriarch Chin's household servants. But now, in her 60s, whatever her merits, and she held many secrets, she was also getting too old. Because of the famine and the civil war, Father readily agreed to the overseas proposal and signed some papers. And so we arrived in Vancouver. Father was 30 years old, and Po Po was almost 70, and I, 3. Popo and I were Father's only two surviving family members before my second birthday. My mother had died from the coughing sickness. Ghosts in old China haunted us, just as they had haunted Third Uncle, and they haunt me today. I now know that only the stillborn can leave the past behind. Thank you.